You are still welcome, most welcome to do so, and anyone who would like to go to your evening, we do have several extra sets still remaining, and please feel free to do so. It will not be disruptive to our service. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to offer words of welcome not only to you, but to our Bat Mitzva, Elaine Weiss, who is going to serve as our chazanit for our service this morning. So I would like to ask you to turn in your Seder ring, in your prayer booklets, to page 2, where Elaine, together with her sister Joanne, will join in leading us in Masov, how goodly it is to be together in the sanctuary.
Amen.
chant for the morning's Kaddish on page 14. Yitgadal mitkadash shemei rabba, yalma mivrachi yutei, yamlich mafutei, v'chayei chon v'yomei chon, v'chayei v'chol beit Yisrael, v'hagalal v'zman karir yiru amein, yehei shemei rabba v'vara, v'alam v'alhei amaya, yitvara v'yishabah, v'yitvahar, v'yitromam, v'yitnaseh, yitadar, yitaler, yitalal, shemei v'kusha, v'yitrom, Leila mi folder fata vishirata, tushbechata venechemata da amiran de alma, viru amen. Yehe shlamara vamishmaya, bachayim, aleinu yalko Yisrael, viru amen. Ose shalom, roma, viase shalom, aleinu yalko Yisrael, viru amen. We turn to page 16 as we stand once again, and we join in saying, Father, shalom.
Thank you.
lots of reading, we cannot really pray.
We cannot really pray for you, O God, for any war. For we know that you have made the world in a way that man must find his own path to peace, within himself and with his neighbor. We cannot merely pray for you, O God, to root out prejudice, for you have already given us eyes with which to see the good in all men, if we would only use them rightly. Search out cures and healings, if we would only use them constructively.
Therefore, we pray that you will set the heart with strength and determination will go on to do the set of justice for and to promise that we are to wish.
For your sake and for ours, speedily and soon, that our land may be safe and that our lives may be blessed.
Not only to be a good Jew,
but to be a leader, to be a potential leader of the Jewish community. And there was a reason for that. And that is that although here, at Shalom, you see women wearing talit every day. And if you look around you, there are many. And in our family, as you know, this is the first. This is a breath of a long tradition where women did not wear talit. Your mother never wore talit, and your grandmothers never wore talit, your great-grandmothers never wore, and I suspect for many, many generations before, no woman has ever worn a talit. And I think, as you know, explaining your speech, there are good reasons why women may wear a talit, and perhaps even should wear a talit. But because of that breath, in a long-standing tradition, I felt that someone very special was needed to break such a tradition. I am more than proud, I am very proud, to present you this talit, more than that.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kitzanu b'mitzvotah v'tzivanu l'utnat shefach kitzu.
We turn now to page 32. We rise as we join with our Bat Mitzva and Baruch.
Oh, I'll see you. Thank you.
Shalom.
invitation to rise as we begin the service for reading from the Sefer Torah. Please sit in the
Last year we read the first third of each weekly portion. This year we are reading the middle third, and next year we will read the final third of each weekly portion. The parsha this week, Kitavo, is found in your books, at least the middle portion of it that Elaine will read today. My discussion, however, today, I would like to cover the complete portion of Kitavo, and in fact, I'd like to go back just a little bit to the Maftir, to the final paragraph read this past Shabbat from Parshat Ki Tetzeh. There, in Deuteronomy 25, we are told how to behave with regard to our recent past, our recent suffering. Zechor et asher asa lecha Amalek. Remember what Amalek did to you are the opening words of the paragraph, and the closing words reiterate, lo tishkach, do not forget. And I believe that we can be satisfied with our collective fulfilling of this commandment, of this mitzvah. The plans for Holocaust Museum here in Washington, and the powerful reminder of Yad Vashem in Yerushalayim, are but two symbols of the many manifestations of our carrying out of this commandment. We will fulfill this commandment today as well, when we read my Bat Mitzvah and his Bar Mitzvah in our prayer books immediately after the Torah reading. As we begin to read Ki Tavo, going from Ki Tetzeh, today's portion, we learn how we are to behave after the era of Galut and Amalek, and into the era of Eretz Zavat Chalav and Dvash, the era of life in our own land, flowing with milk and honey. Are we doing as good a job fulfilling these commandments concerning the new land as we are fulfilling the commandments related to our recent past? In that land today, the most controversial issue revolves around how we are to deal with the non-Jews in our midst. Is Israel meant to be an exclusively Jewish state, or a state of Jews, Arabs, and Christians? Should we maintain as much social isolation as possible between the Jewish and non-Jewish communities, or should we encourage interaction? Do Christians have the same rights as Jews to build our Ha'atzofim on Mount Scopus? Are democracy and religious tolerance concepts foreign to Judaism, or are they in fact rooted in Jewish law? I think we can find the answer to these questions in today's Pasha. V'hayah ki tavo el haaretz asher Hashem Elokecha noten lach nachala v'yirishcha v'yashavta ba. The portion opens by setting the time and the place. And this is how it shall be when you come to the land that God has given you as a heritage, and you occupy it, and settle it. And then the Torah orders us in chapter 26, verse 11, V'samachta b'chol atov asher matan lecha Hashem Elokecha u'leveitecha ata v'halevi v'hager asher v'kibbecha. And you shall enjoy together with the Levite and the stranger in your midst all the bounty that the Lord your God has bestowed upon you and your household. Not only are we not commanded to rid our land of the stranger in our midst, but we are in fact commanded to enjoy the bounty of Eretz Yisrael with him. And to make it abundantly clear, this mitzvah asay, this positive mitzvah, is followed in chapter 27 by a parallel law, a prohibition, a negative mitzvah. Ahu matei mishtah, ger yatom ve'almana. Cursed is he who subverts the rights of the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow. God warns us against depriving the stranger of equal rights even before the orphan and the widow. The Jewish people have suffered a long history of persecution at the hands of many different peoples. It's therefore not surprising that among us there exists a small minority who have come to believe that all non-Jews are Amalek. They would have us apply the commandment never forget to Arabs, Christians, and even to non-Orthodox Jews. This week's reading requires us to remember who we are and what our relationships with others must be. We are required upon entering the new land, the land of Israel, as we offer the first fruits of our first harvest to the Kohen, to recite out loud the passage beginning, Arami Oved Avi. My father was a wandering Aramean. Abraham Avinu, Abraham our father, was a nomad from the land of Aram. Who can forget, after reciting this passage, that his Arab and Christian neighbors are brothers, children of the very same Arami? How far does God begin to carry this brotherhood? After all, charity begins at home. In today's portion, God tells us that even charity may not be restricted to the Jewish people alone. In chapter 26, verse 12, we learn that we must give a tithe, a tenth of the harvest, to la levi, la ger, la yatom, la almana, to the Levite, the stranger, the orphan, and the widow. As we continue further on in Parshat Ki Tavoh, we come to the part to be chanted today. We are told here of the blessings that will come to us if we follow these commandments, and the misfortunes which will come to us if we do not, the plagues that will come to us if we do not. In accordance with tradition, Elaine will chant the account of the blessings slowly in a loud voice, but when she reaches the Tochecha, the account of the misfortunes which might come, she will lower her voice and read through them without a pause. Perhaps there's a lesson here as well. When we consider the possible consequences of interaction with different peoples, and welcoming strangers to share with us, we can envision different outcomes. We can imagine blessings, but at times we might fear tragedy would result. Perhaps this tradition of bringing the Tochecha quickly and in a low voice refers to this problem. Perhaps we ought not to pause in order to stress hypothetical tragic outcomes of brotherhood, but rather allow optimism, a loud, clear voice.
Sorry. Yeah.
When I was 13, I became Bat Mitzva.
When he was 13, he became Bat Mitzva.
Today I am celebrating becoming Bat Mitzva. When I was 13, I studied the pathways of the Torah and the roadways of the Talmud. And my Bat Mitzva, I took an oath to live as a Jew. At my Bat Mitzva, I bless God. At my Bat Mitzva, I lifted my voice and sang. At my Bat Mitzva, I read from the scroll of the Torah. At my Bat Mitzva, I wore a new tallit over a new dress. At my Bat Mitzva, I started on my road of life. At my Bat Mitzva, my family and friends came to say l'chaim. At my Bat Mitzva, they praised my voice, my song, my melody. When I was 13, I was called up to the Torah. I went to the Bima. When I was 13, I became Bat Mitzva and lived.
Turn to page 78. We rise now as we return our Sept to the end.
Today, as I become a Bat Mitzva, I am wearing a tallit, Tzedut and Halakha, am I performing a mitzvah, that is, a commandment, committing a transgression, or neither? To find the answer to this question, I went to Talmud and other halakhic sources. There are several issues concerning the wearing of a talit. First, is a woman permitted to wear a talit? I found no place where it was specifically prohibited. In fact, Michal, the wife of King David, is said to have worn tefillin, which is a mitzvah in the same category as wearing a talit. There is a prohibition, however, against a woman wearing beged ish, that is, a man's clothing. But is a talit beged ish? In our society, beged ish can be difficult to define. Is a sweatshirt beged ish? In other times, they were. In other places, they still might be. But today in America, both men and women wear it. In congregations all over the United States, more and more women are wearing talit. It is doubtful that they are still beged ish. If a woman wishes to be extra careful, she can certainly choose a talit designed especially for women. If a woman is permitted to wear a talit, the next question is a woman obligated to wear it? According to Halakha, women are not obligated to perform all the mitzvot that men are. In the Mishnah Kiddushin, Lamed Gimel, we read, the kol mitzvot aseh, shemizman gramah, anashim chayavim, v'nashim turot. All positive commandments, which are time-bound, men are obligated and women are exempt. Many scholars explain that women are exempt from time-bound obligations because of their family obligations. A woman's traditional role is to take care of her family. Time-bound obligations would interfere with this role. Many women today, however, have no children, have grown-up children, or work outside of the home anyway. Others are not married. I wonder if for such women, positive time-bound mitzvahs, such as the wearing of a talit, might be required. For those women for whom the wearing of the talit is optional, another issue arises. Although there is a debate among halakhic scholars as to whether one should voluntarily take on obligations, many look upon it favorably. Some, however, would prohibit the saying of the bracha or blessing for a mitzvah which is optional. The next question is, are women permitted to read Torah for a congregation? This brings up a more basic question. Are women permitted to learn Torah at all? We know that a woman must learn Torah in order to be able to fulfill the mitzvot. However, in the Talmud Sotah, Daphet Srin, we find a debate between Ben Asai, who says, Chayav Adam l'lameh et bito Torah, a man must teach his daughter Torah, and Rabbi Eliezer, who says, Kol ha'lameh bito Torah ki'ilu lomda kiklu, whoever teaches his daughter Torah teaches her not. It is clear to me that the second opinion no longer holds. We no longer believe that women's intelligence is inferior. In fact, the Talmud itself talks of Buria, the wife of Rabbi Meir, who is said to have been as great a scholar as many of the rabbis. Is a woman then permitted to read Torah for the congregation? This question depends not on whether a woman is permitted to study Torah, but rather on whether she is required to study Torah. When a reader of Torah reads for the kahal, or congregation, he or she absolves the members of the kahal of their obligation to read. But you can only absolve another person if you yourself are also obligated to perform the mitzvah. There is an argument on the subject of whether or not women are required to learn Torah. That women are obligated to hear the Torah being read seems to be true. Because it is written in Dvarim, Lamed-Ha. Hakel et ha'am, ha'anashim, ha'anashim ve'ha'am. Ve'gerfa, asher v'sharacha. L'ma'a yishmeu, v'l'ma'a yimedu. Ve'aru et adonai elohecha. Ve'shamru la'atha, et kol divrei ha'sharacha. That is, in Deuteronomy chapter 31, it says, gather the people, men, women, and children, and the strangers in your community, that they may hear and so learn to revere the Lord your God, and to observe faithfully every word of his teaching. This passage is clear. Men and women alike are required to listen and to learn. However, several halakhic authorities believe that a different passage is the source of the commandment to learn Torah. In Dvarim, Yodal, Deuteronomy chapter 11, we find, and you shall teach them to yourself. Because there are no vowels in the Torah, the rabbis read this phrase two ways. It could mean either Belimatem, and you shall teach, or Belimatem, and you shall study. The rabbis concluded from this double meaning that because no one is required to teach his daughter, she is not required to teach herself to study Torah. I have a doubt about this interpretation. The whole idea hinges on the theory that B'nai Chen means son and not daughter. However, the Hebrew word for your children, meaning both boys and girls, is B'nai Chen. The same word is for your son. This makes me think that women are not exempt, but in fact, are obligated to study Torah just as boys are, even if we accept the second passage as the source of the mitzvah. If a woman is obligated to listen to Torah in synagogue, then she may also serve as the reader, and the congregation is absorbed through her reading. My next question concerns whether a woman may have an aliyah. We are told in Megillah, Kafkel, Tani Rabbanah, Hakol Ali Mitzvah Shi'ah Ve'afinu Kashar Ve'afinu Isha Ava Amru Hachami Isha Lo Shikha Vachara Yifnei Bod HaTzibur. This means that all are qualified to be among the seven people who receive Aliyah, including women. The sages say that the only problem with the woman receiving an Aliyah is Bod HaTzibur, the honor of the congregation. The sages are saying that if a woman were to receive an aliyah, it would look as if the men seated in the congregation were unfit to say the blessing. This would dishonor the congregation, but this dishonor occurs only if we believe that the women in the congregation are inferior to the men. Today, in the United States, it is accepted that women are intellectually equal to men. Therefore, there are no lack of objections that I can see to a woman receiving an aliyah. The fourth issue is the most difficult. It is the question of a woman serving as shlichat tzibur, or leader of the congregation. This is basically the question of it being a positive time-bound mitzvah. We have already stated that a woman is exempt, and it is therefore illegal for her to perform the mitzvah for the congregation. But I am too young to have a family to take care of. I believe that this makes me eligible to be the shlichat tzibur. It won't interrupt my regular schedule. This is true for any woman who doesn't have a family or works outside of her home. As for women who aren't exempt, according to that logic, we live in a society where most women aren't expected to stay in the house office. This causes me to think that almost all women are now eligible to serve as shlichot tzibur. Many of the questions I have discussed do not have only one possible answer. There are disagreements among halakhic experts and among the main branches of Judaism. What does halakha itself have to say about disagreement or doubt? Where is the seat studying Torah and teaching Torah to your children are mitzvot directly from the Torah, that is, de'oraita. The Talmud teaches us that, safek de'oraita l'kumra, a doubt related to a Torah commandment must be treated strictly. That is, If there is a doubt as to whether such laws apply to women, we must treat the commandment strictly and apply it to women as well as to men. Are we permitted to allow traditions to change? Does halakha allow for flexibility? Does halakha allow us to take into account such issues as women's status in the world today, and the issue of Jewish survival, the need to accommodate for the sake of Israel as a whole? Are we permitted to consider secular issues in halakhic questions? Careful study of halakhic history shows that we may take secular issues into consideration. An example is the way halakha considers economic matters. If one is prepared a large pot of meat stew, and a half a stick of butter falls into the pot, what does one do according to halakha? Throw out the stew? Destroy the pot? Kasher the pot? No. According to halakha, one goes ahead and eats the stew. According to the rule of Batel B'Shishi, the rabbi decided that a small quantity of dairy accidentally mixed with meat should not cause the waste of the whole dish. The possible loss we are discussing today is much greater than the loss of a pot of stew. Women, who are not allowed to participate fully in Judaism, may lose interest and become assimilated. If all of us do not follow the halakhic principles of accommodation and flexibility, we may lose many Jews forever.
I think the entire congregation this morning was treated to a wonderful halakhic dissertation, and I, for one, want to register my vote.